So, challenges. There are numerous challenges to facilitating change, and we don't have time to go into them all today. But here's just a kind of a few that we need to be aware of. First of all, our belief systems. We have an innate need to maintain or enhance our view of ourselves. The brain is particularly sensitive to situations which potentially threaten our self-image. So, if you've attended previous webinars, you'll have heard me talk about either the scare or the scarf model. They're both the same model, just slightly different words. And self-image is linked to that significance or status domain in those models. Our once established, our belief systems are self-validating. They go in search of data to validate that our beliefs are correct. And once we get into that and they're established and self-validating, then they are very, very hard to change. The second challenge, something known as biased choice value. The choices we make are likely to be biased by our past experiences and the values that we place upon the alternative options that's available at that moment. So, if we have previously been involved with a change that, from our perspective, I'm not saying the change was actually successful in actually achieving what it was set out to, but if it's been successful from the individual's perspective, then their brain will have automatically attached positive outcomes to it. So, whenever any future change comes up, however they responded to past change, their brain will be pushing them, motivating them, driving them to take similar action again, even if there are other options out there that actually, do make sense. There is some alternative out there, and there is evidence pointing to the alternatives, but the brain is more likely to go for past experience because that creates certainty. And again, certainty is something that the brain craves. We've also got to remember that, when people are stressed, and let's face it, as many people are during ongoing change, even though they may be trying hard to focus on the change, in reality, they're often most likely to revert back to old ways because the brain is just so overwhelmed, it's really struggling, and it doesn't have the energy to suppress all the old habits and the old ways of doing things. It takes an awful lot of energy to remember to do things the new way, to do things differently. And if our brain is overwhelmed and fatigued and stressed, then it just doesn't have the energy available to do that suppression. Cognitive dissonance is another reason, another challenge when we're thinking about change. And this occurs when there's conflicting or inconsistent data. For example, when an individual's behavior isn't consistent with their thoughts and beliefs. So, for change to take place, individuals must be able to commit to the new way of doing something and also be motivated towards the new thinking and the goals. That will then lead new attitudes being formed. And when new attitudes are formed and aligned to the change is more likely to be successful in the long term. Now, there's many reasons why people refuse to change behavior, even when it can be viewed as being desirable. One example of this is a threat may have been experienced in one, more, or all even of the scare, scarf, social domains. So, for example, if people haven't been given the opportunity to draw their own conclusions, if they've just been informed that this change is a good thing, they haven't been given the kind of the flip side of that, the downside, as well as the positives, then in actual fact, that's created a threat, an autonomy threat on their scare domains. Or The other thing that can get in the way, a challenge that we need to be aware of, is if an individual is already experiencing stress and cognitive overload, then they may be struggling to make rational decisions and choices. There's something called the protective versus productive mode. Now, it's perfectly understandable when, given all of the uncertainty and challenges associated with change, that previously high-performing individuals or even whole teams can move into a state of threat. And when we move into that threat state, we focus upon keeping safe. We keep our heads down. We become hypervigilant to risk, less innovative. We move to that kind of black or white, either or type thinking. We move into what is known as the protective mode. And when we're in protective mode, we make decisions based on our past experiences. We're more likely to feel that we don't matter, especially when we don't have a say in the change. We look for evidence to confirm our beliefs that change is bad. And we will definitely be experiencing threat in probably all five of those scare scarf domains. So significance, certainty, autonomy, relatedness, and equity. So it means that we lose that motivation and we end up just doing the bare minimum required of us. Now, it's also important to remember or to be aware that we experience change in different ways and we all find different things stressful. And some people may already be at that maximum cognitive load before they even get to work and have to cope with the change. You know, just taking into account the things like the cost of living crisis, caring for loved ones, relationship issues. These are all things that for some people can create that absolute maximum cognitive overload. So this means we should really think about the protective and productive modes as a continuum, with people being at different stages, different places on that continuum. So when a change is first announced, it's really natural, as we've said, to see a shift towards protective mode, even in teams who have been previously highly productive teams. Now, the degree of longevity of that shift will be influenced by several factors that are within the control of our leaders. Just some of those things. First of all, psychological safety. How safe do team members actually feel? How psychologically safe is your organisation? The individual's appetite and capacity for change, which relates back to all those things I've been talking about, the cognitive overload. What else is going on for the individual in their life? And the triggering of that threat reward response in the scare domains. Are people experiencing more threats than rewards? The last challenge we'll mention today is when too much change is expected in too short a time scale, which leads to overwhelm. So the brain's a very powerful organ that can be likened to a smartphone. If you've got too many apps open on your smartphone, the energy drains very quickly. You quickly end up with a flat battery. And the brain is the same. When presented with too much information, too much change in too short a time, then information overload occurs. Change fatigue can set in. The brain can only process and focus attention on 2 to 3 pieces of information at any one time. So to minimize this, it's important that we focus on small chunks of change. That way, we're actually working in line with the workings of the brain. We're working within the capacity of the brain. We're minimizing that risk of fatigue and overwhelm. And ideally, what we should be doing of is breaking the change down into chunks, which can be accomplished within 90 days, or 91 days is the actual, because that's exactly a quarter of a year. So 91 days. So rather than announcing huge change initiatives, they need to be broken down into smaller chunks if we want to make them more manageable, more successful.